Hi, everybody. My name is Andrew Waters. I'm with Quantum Sales, and I'm based out of Annapolis, Maryland. Thanks for joining us today. We've got a hopefully a really nice, informative, good little webinar for you based on the topic of offshore cruising, weather 101. And I'm privileged today to be joined by Chelsea Carlson from SeaTactics. And I don't want to keep too much rambling on, so I'll just move straight over to Chelsea. Thanks for joining us today, Chelsea. And I'm really looking forward to presenting this with you. And over to you.
Cool. Thanks, Andrew. Yeah, I'm happy to be here and talk to you guys a little bit about offshore weather intro. So my name's Chelsea. I'm a meteorologist based out of Florida. And I'm also a sailor. So been looking at weather since I was a kid and started applying it to sailing, you know, once I got my meteorology degree. So I'm going to jump right in and we're going to look at a couple of different topics for offshore cruisers. This is our welcome intro with some information there. So we're going to talk a little bit about what to know before you go. So before you head offshore, maybe you're a coastal sailor and you're thinking about taking one of your first maybe offshore trips a little further away from home or an overnight sail. So we'll talk about weather windows, how to pick the right one, a little bit about thunderstorms, some safety aspects, boat and sail preparation for different kinds of weather conditions. And then at the end, we'll talk a little bit about the elusive weather models that everyone has heard so much about. And we will hopefully give you guys some clarification on what the weather models are all about. Sounds good. So starting it off with weather windows. So one of the things you want to look for is a long enough weather window. And what we're looking for here is enough time to have a little bit of extra, I say about 12 to 24 hours on either side of when it looks like the weather is supposed to be good. And that's basically just in case. I mean, we all know the weather changes, and in case something does change or shift while you're out there, you don't really want to be pulling up to your port or pulling up to your destination on the heels of something that's coming in. It puts pressure on you and pressure on the crew that I think, you know, may put you into a situation where you're pushing the boat and pushing the crew maybe further than they should be pushing themselves to try to make it in before like a front or a storm. So I always say I work with clients all the time doing routing and finding these weather windows. So one of the most important things is finding a conservative but realistic planned boat speed. You don't want to overestimate it as far as, oh yeah, we're going to do 10 knots the whole time. And you also don't want to underestimate it because then your planned, you know, where you're going to be along with the weather system may be off if you're actually going faster than what you estimated. So, Andrew, do you have any comments on that about boat speed?
Yeah, I find it, thanks, Chelsea. I find it quite interesting because there's always seems to be, like you say, the either an overestimation or an underestimation. At the end of the day, though, if you plan a passage, it's very, very difficult to stick to that time frame. Most of the time, I would say that you fall behind it, just because of unforeseen circumstances that come about. Be that a sail change that takes a little bit longer, or you know, you might find yourself in a situation where you are hove to, or the boat isn't performing quite as well as you thought it might be, or you know. If you're lucky enough, you've got a big fish on the line and it takes 30 minutes to pull that in. You know, all of it at the end of the day adds up. I liken it a little bit to going on a road trip. You know, you might plan that the road trip's going to take 5 or 6 hours, but you know, when you add up all the various little pit stops that you do and think they may take 10 minutes, but each one might take 15, it'll add on to it soon enough. So certainly being a bit conservative in that regard, I think is important.
Yeah, absolutely. And I've worked with people that have picked a weather window that was, you know, just big enough, like, oh yeah, I think we can make it in this time. And then, something inevitably always happens, right? You know, the motor has an issue, or you rip a sail, or, you know, someone's seasick, or, you know, anything could happen. And so I think just having that extra time, by both planning for a conservative speed and picking a time frame where you know you're going to have good weather on either side, I think that's really important.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
Awesome. So we're going to get into just a little weather basics here. So most of you guys, you may or may not know this, but just the basics of high and low pressure. So high pressure is associated with sinking air, clear skies, and generally fair weather. And then low pressure is generally, it's kind of associated with some storminess, a lot more clouds, and that's mainly because the air is rising. So when we're looking for a weather window, the key is really to look for high pressure that is moving fairly slowly to give you a good chunk of time. And things we want to avoid, you know, obviously are developing low pressures and then fast moving lows. So if we get into a weather pattern where the systems are moving very quickly and developing very rapidly, it's not only obviously more dangerous to be out there, but it gets harder to predict, you know, where exactly the lows will develop or how fast they'll move. So that's kind of just the rule of thumb. And this example on the right is a good picture of just a surface weather map, and you can get this from NOAA or a lot of sources online. So I really recommend checking out, you know, NOAA, looking at some surface weather maps, finding the high pressures and seeing how fast they're moving. And we'll talk a little bit about that when we look at weather models. So the next thing is obviously picking what time of year you're gonna go. We want to avoid the shoulder seasons if possible. And so that's basically late fall and early spring. Those transition times are not only more difficult to predict what the weather's doing, the models are going to have trouble necessarily telling you when the weather windows are going to be, but it's when things are just generally more unpredictable, right? So storms kind of pop up out of nowhere, and the weather pattern tends to be more intense and unpredictable. So summertime is obviously much easier. North Atlantic hurricane season is something we do have to consider a little bit. It runs from June 1st to November 30th, but honestly, it's usually not a major problem, especially if you're at the higher latitudes in the June-July timeframe. So you can do plenty of, short or long coastal trips or offshore trips in June and even in July, because if you're at the higher latitudes, maybe not so much in the Caribbean, but if you're at the higher latitudes, we generally have a good heads up time when the storms are going to develop. And so if it's a short cruise, you should have plenty of time to know what's coming. Now, the iffy time frame is around August or September. That's the peak of hurricane season, and that's when we really want to just be more cautious about how far away we go or how long the trips are. It's not a great time to be doing like a long trip to Bermuda or, you know, maybe multiple day trips. But short trips, you can certainly see far enough in advance to know that it's going to be all right. And then the windows, you know, just to note, they're often much shorter in the fall. And the problem with the fall is that you're always trying to rush to get the window in before winter comes. So it's like you start running out of time. You're like, oh no, it's getting to be November. And, you know, you start trying to, every window you see, you're like, okay, can we do a trip here? Can we do that? And so it's a little bit easier if you wait until the spring. Springtime is really good because the longer you wait, the better the weather gets. So especially right now, this time of year, it's actually still pretty active, even for early May. I have clients that are looking for weather windows, and even in May, they're tough to find a long enough window to do a long trip. So it's generally better. You can always wait until June, and things will get easier. If you're going, a popular route is Annapolis to the Caribbean, and vice versa. You know, this year, everyone's probably coming up from the Caribbean back to Annapolis, and you know, this time of year is good because you can just wait a couple weeks if it doesn't look like it's very good. And right now the weather is busy. It doesn't look that simple. So this is what we're looking at here is general pressure systems, but based on the seasons, right? So this is the average sea level pressure in January. So again, this probably just highlights stuff you guys probably already know, but high pressure is generally over the United States. And then the Bermuda high, which is the one that we like to look at a lot, it's pushed all the way over by Europe. So we have this big gap off the East Coast and even down by Florida where systems have the ability to spin up and to roll through and roll off the coast. So wintertime, there's this gap that opens for systems to develop, makes it a little tougher. And in the Pacific, we have a big Aleutian low up by Alaska that spins off storms. And those storms come in and affect California on the West Coast. And this Pacific high that usually brings fairly nice weather is also fairly small and pushed down south. So those are some of the features that we're watching in the wintertime. How strong are those highs? Where are they located? And a meteorologist can definitely help you figure this out if it's unfamiliar to you. This is exactly the opposite. So this is July. The surface pressures, generally, the Pacific high is nice and big. It's taken up, you know, the whole Pacific for the most part, gives you those nice transpac routes from California to Hawaii. There's usually some hot weather over the United States, which brings a low pressure right in the middle. And then, of course, our Bermuda high in the Atlantic gets nice and big. And so nice trade winds across the Caribbean, pretty good trade winds across most of the southern U.S. So it becomes much easier to navigate around this big Bermuda high, you know, than worrying about storms that are developing. So the placement of the Bermuda high definitely plays a role. And the closer it is to the U.S. and the stronger it is, there's no space there for storms to develop. So it becomes much nicer weather. All right. So this is a question I get a lot from clients about thunderstorms, which is how to, you know, plan to avoid them. We all know you have to prepare just in case you run into one, because let's be honest, we're on the water and there's a lot of moisture and thunderstorms can just pop up sometimes. So you have to be prepared, but obviously you want to plan to avoid getting yourself into a situation where you have a high risk, right? So things we want to talk about are reducing our risk, and then we'll get into what to do actually on board the boat. So reducing the risk is going to be avoiding those low pressure centers we talked about, and any type of front. So whether it's a cold front or a warm front, you know, you can look at the weather maps or consult like NOAA to figure out where some of the fronts are, but we want to avoid fronts because there's always a chance for some kind of storms or electrical activity near them. And the other thing is, especially if we're cruising or maybe using the Gulf Stream to maybe take a cruise up to Maine or, you know, even up towards Hatteras, we like to tell people to use the Gulf Stream. It's a great tool, but just know that there's inherently a higher risk for thunderstorms over the Gulf Stream, right? So you have this very warm water, and usually the air above it is much cooler. So that creates some instability, what we call unstable air, right? Because warm air wants to rise, cold air wants to sink. So when we have cold over warm, it creates a lot of instability. And that's how you could get the overturning and the thunderstorms to develop, right? So, and this goes for cold fronts that are moving over warm water. It's the same thing. So if you have a cold air mass, like this time of year, it's been fairly cold in the Northeast. When those storms move out over the you know, relatively warmer water, you run the risk for thunderstorms. So you kind of avoid situations like that. And the other time is just after sunset and just before sunrise, even in the trade winds in the Caribbean and Florida, you'll end up with a little bit higher risk for thunderstorms around that because the temperature is changing very quickly. So it leads to some instability there. All right, and it's going to, let's pass it over to Andrew for some info on what to do on board for thunderstorms.
Thanks, Chelsea. That's really helpful. The thunderstorm topic of it is obviously pretty important, but I think it can be generalized as well to passage making and any systems that might be coming your way. But the thunderstorm aspect of it certainly highlights any given time of the day, and it demands perhaps a little bit more speedy work, whereas if you were offshore and you knew there was a system coming through, you might have a little bit more time. But I think all of the points that I'm about to touch on apply no matter where you are, whether it be in a thunderstorm or knowing that there's some inclement weather that might be coming through. And this isn't really in any particular order, but certainly reefing early is more beneficial. Often with these thunderstorms, certainly on one side of them, there's an increased velocity of wind. So putting a reef in or furling up a head sail a little bit earlier rather than doing it when it arrives, you'll probably find it's more more pleasing and more comfortable, particularly for your crew and those slightly less experienced. Sort of once that's done, you might want to just double check on the deck to make sure there's no lines, no clutter that can go over the side, get caught around a propeller or a rudder or something along those lines. It's not trying to dramatize the whole situation. These things should probably be done on a fairly regular basis, but it's a good time just to double check. Hatches, it's obvious, but sometimes they do get left either not completely dogged down, and that again can just make things uncomfortable down below if there's a hatch over your bunk that's left open and then your bed gets wet. It's not very pleasant. It's not that dangerous, but it just isn't very pleasant. If you are particularly nervous, you know, hoving to is a pretty safe maneuver. You can stop a boat, you can be very safe, you can literally, as us English people like to do, have a cup of tea and wait for it all to blow over. Got to make sure, however, if you do that, you've got to make sure that you've got plenty of seaway to leeward of you. And then the last thing is, there's nothing more uncomfortable than being wet, soggy, cold, or otherwise. So it is important to take that, allow that time at least, to get the right equipment on you and make sure your crew members are all comfortable as well. It's much easier to take wet clothes off than to try and be comfortable with wet clothes as you're moving along. So there's just a couple of little points which are general, but certainly useful if you see a thunderstorm rolling over the horizon and you've got time. It's just you plan all those 5 points there, and I think you'd be more comfortable and certainly be a bit safer.
Yeah, definitely. Awesome. Thanks, Andrew. And I have a question for you that this just popped into my head as you were talking. I've sailed into some thunderstorms that had quite a bit of electrical activity in them before. What's your take on, you know, taking some electronics like a GPS or a sat phone, if you have that, and putting it in the oven as a Faraday cage? Is that something you would recommend?
Wow, it's something I've never heard of. But yeah, I don't, it's a good question. I might have to do a little research on it. But I think that generally speaking, you know, most boats these days, most modern boats, and certainly ones that are doing some serious offshore or blue water cruising, have some quite sophisticated navigation equipment. And with them, you know, the grounding of the boats is important. But I think it's also pretty smart. And I suppose probably most people, because they're so inexpensive now and very reliable, will have some form of portable backups, certainly in terms of GPS and so on and so forth. But there was something in terms of equipment, which will become useful if you do have it. By using radar, you know, you can see thunderstorms coming, particularly at nighttime. You know, if you've just got a radar going on, it is easier to see these storms coming through if you can't see it through the night. But I'm going to look into that, sticking things in the oven. I'm not entirely certain, but maybe. But a backup plan for a portable GPS, I would imagine, is probably fairly high on the list of safety spares.
Yeah, definitely. And that's a good point about having the visibility as well, because at night, especially if it's like a new moon or there's no moonlight, it becomes really difficult to see the actual clouds on the horizon coming towards you. So yeah, have a radar, definitely use that. And I love looking at radar. The few boats that I've been on offshore at night, I was wishing we had radar and seeing the thunderstorms coming. Cool. Really good tips. Yeah. Cool. So yeah, Andrew, you want to talk a little bit more about maybe some of the boat and sail prep?
Yeah, so great. The thing that I was thinking about here, Chelsea, was not necessarily whilst you're out there, but a little bit more about before you actually go out. so much of the safety aspect of going offshore is done before you even get out there. There was a guy when I was really just getting going and learning, he always referred to, you know, if there's a chink in your armor, the sea's going to find it. And, you know, you can't really put enough preparation into going offshore or planning a passage. And it certainly isn't something that you need to be rushed. And I've just got a couple of bullet points here that, you know, just to jot down in your little notebook of things that you should do, whether your sails are quite new or you know, getting a little long in the tooth, it's worthwhile getting them into your sailmaker and just having them serviced and checked over and make sure that everything about them is as good as you can make them. They're likely to be your engine out there, and you need to be able to rely on them a lot more than you really can if you do have an engine working or not, you know. So it's important to get your sails serviced well ahead in advance and make sure that you're confident with that. Likewise, you know, the safety gear check, it may seem obvious, but you know, if you look at all of your safety equipment, there's quite a lot of it. To make sure that the flares are all in date, just double check, even if you think that you're good to go. Check to make sure that all the life jackets, for example, have whistles on them, that they are all prepared in the way that they should be. And any other safety equipment that you happen to have, a life raft, is it in service date? EPIRBs, are they registered? All those sort of things. Nobody really expects to end up in a situation, but if you get into one and that's when you find out that your safety equipment isn't up to date or isn't where it should be or marked to use it how it should be, just to help everybody who could be using it, you know, that's a chink in your armor and you'll get caught out. The other thing is the navigation equipment. We've touched on it, you know, in years gone by. You know, it was your sextant, and you would head out there and you would make sure that you've got your sextants in good working order. The almanacs are all right, and it's no different now, you know, whether you've got one, two, or three GPSs or whatever the electronic equipment is. Turning it on and make sure it turns on is one thing, but actually go out and test that you understand how it operates and how it works and how you can get the best out of it. It's certainly worthwhile. So take that time to go through that and make sure that you can almost work on it, you know, because there are going to be times at 2 o'clock in the morning where you're just dog tired, and make sure that you understand how to read it, how to page through all the various things. The next thing is the provision planning. It seems obvious, but it really takes a lot of planning to work out what food you're going to need, how much of it you're going to need, what people can eat, what they can't eat, what they do want to eat, what they don't want to eat. You know, what is good food to put into your body at certain times, you know? It takes quite a lot of planning. And when you're cruising, at least, you know, going back to what we discussed before, just plan for an extra day or 2 days or 3 days being out there. Because when you start to run out of food, emotional states change. When people get hungry, they can get a bit testy from time to time. So that's another important aspect that I always touch on. And then really down to what we're discussing right now, just absolutely know what your routing analysis is. And when the people come speak to you, Chelsea, it's important to have the discussion within yourself and within your router that, you know, we're going to be ready to go from Sunday afternoon. That doesn't mean that you go on Sunday afternoon. Talk it through. Really look at what it is that's ahead of you, and don't try to rush through a gap just to get from A to B. You know, if you're ready to go on Sunday, that's great, but you might actually only leave the next Wednesday, and that's okay. You know, you're cruising, and that's what this topic's all about. Cruise, relax, enjoy it, and try not to rush it. You know, it's very different if you're racing. You know, the race starts at 11 o'clock on Saturday, and the weather that you get is what you've got. Cruising is a completely different thing. We can take our time and pick that window and make sure that you've got enough space in it. And I think you're doing a great job of highlighting that for us. But that's kind of like my five bullet points to get yourself ready to go.
Yeah, and I like your point, Andrew, about the routing analysis and really understanding what it is that you're, you know, getting into. One thing I would advise people to do also is just have an idea in your head of what happens if you are making really good speed. Maybe the winds are a little stronger and maybe you're cooking along. Know what's kind of coming up ahead of you. And then same thing for in case you're a little bit slower. We kind of already touched on that, but in case your speeds are not what you expected for some reason, just know what's happening with the weather behind you as well. So knowing what, you know, what is coming ahead, and if I'm a little fast, I might get into some fresher winds, or if I'm a little slow, you know, I might have a couple showers coming. So whatever those little things are, that kind of gives you a picture of like, okay, I know what's going to happen. You know what to be prepared for. And yeah, it just gives you the peace of mind and allows you to enjoy it rather than stress about it, right?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think that's a great point. And you know, some boats are fortunate enough, they can have constant and ongoing communication with the mainland wherever they are, but some boats aren't. So having an understanding of what, not necessarily is, you know, if you're planning on a 5-day or a 6-day passage, if you're out there in day 7 and day 8, understand ahead of time what you might be running into, just exactly like what you're talking about. And if you see that you're running behind, anticipate the next system. You know, try to get to the right side of what you know is coming so that you can adapt in this and the safest and the most comfortable way for yourself and the crew and the boat. It's a very good point.
Awesome. Yeah. So I hope to give you guys a little understanding now, or at least the beginning of an understanding maybe of some of these weather models, that it may seem like either something that's way too advanced, or, you know, it's complicated, or it's, you know, unnecessary. And, oh, I'm just going to look at, you know, my weather app or NOAA, which there's nothing wrong with that. I definitely encourage people to look, especially at National Weather Service and Ocean Prediction Center. They put out, I mean, really awesome products. But there's something to be said too about just understanding the basics of weather models and kind of how you can use those, you know, to your advantage, to helping you pick the weather windows, right? And so, of course, you can always work with like an expert like myself, or talk to you know, someone who's much more experienced with maybe going offshore. But for those of you that are, you know, really kind of looking at doing this yourself and pulling up the models, it's not hard. You can get the GRIB files, which is what just the file type that the weather info is contained in. And if you use routing programs like Expedition or Adrena, PredictWind, anything like that, you can get these GRIB files in there and then visualize, right, what's gonna happen. So people ask this question a lot, the accuracy of the weather models. So this is always a big question, and it's not a simple answer, except for that it really just depends on the time of year and what's going on in the weather pattern as to how accurate those models are going to be. To give you a little idea, this comes from NOAA, when you have the weather models plus human skill, so that's someone like me, like a meteorologist, interpreting that data and putting out a forecast for you, the 5-day forecast accuracy is going to be right about 90% of the time. A 7-day, looking out 7 days, it goes down to about 80%. And then once you get to 10 days or more, the accuracy of any forecast really goes down to about 50%. So you want to keep that in mind, especially if you're going to think about something like a really long trip, which is definitely something you can do if you want to go to Bermuda, you know, sail from the Northeast down to the Caribbean, or maybe even across the Atlantic. Just know that especially beyond 7 to 10 days, things start getting really iffy. And what you're looking at is probably just a very decent guess. whereas anything within 3 to 5 days is going to, most of the time, is going to be pretty good, especially if it's a stable season, like it's summertime. That Bermuda high that I was talking about, if it just is set in its spot, it doesn't really look like it's moving that much, you can have a really good estimate that for about 5 days out, you pretty much have an idea of what exactly is going to happen. So yeah, the point there being that if you're just looking at the model by itself, the accuracy is very low. So there is a famous statistician that said, all models are wrong. And some models are useful. So by definition, they're all just guessing at what's happening in the atmosphere. Some of them are more useful than others. Understand that they're tools for our toolbox. But having just a basic understanding of how the weather works, I think is invaluable. It doesn't tie you down to something that's electronic, like, you know, an app or a weather model to pinpoint your safety on, you know? So having some understanding and knowing that the models are really just a tool and they're never going to get it right 100% of the time. You guys probably already know this. If you've watched any of the hurricane spaghetti models, they're all over the place, but the hurricanes are kind of their own separate thing. On a regular, you know, summer day, the weather models are going to do much better than those hurricane spaghetti models. One thing I wanted to mention is a piece of software that I use called Model Accuracy. So you can actually compare the weather models to real wind data that's on your boat. So the wind anemometer at the top of your mast, you can compare it and say, well, which weather model is matching up to what's happening to the wind on top of my mast right now? Or it also works with like a nearby weather buoy. But I find this is really helpful to just give you that quick, you know, without having to dive deep into what the weather models are doing. You know, oh, which one seemed right and what happened yesterday? And is this one, you know, more accurate today? This just gives you a numerical analysis. This model is performing best compared to what's actually happening right at my spot. So if you're able to download the GRIB files while you're out sailing, which if you have any kind of just basic internet connection, you can do through Sail Docs or Predict Wind. There's a couple out there. You can compare them and just see what's good. And that's going to be really immensely helpful. So you're not sitting there trying to figure out a puzzle while you're sailing, and maybe there's storms and there's all these things going on. So having it sorted before you go out is probably a good thing. Just knowing like, okay, this model has been working pretty well. I'm going to look at this one before I go out. And then when we are out there sailing, we can assess how things change, right? Because things are always changing once you're actually out on the water. Part of what I do when I go out sailing is look at the models before I go out, do my whole prediction and just try to understand what's going to happen. And then once you get out there, you're trying to kind of constantly adjust the forecast based on what you see, right? So, okay, I know there was supposed to be a chance of, you know, that front was supposed to come through at noon and it's only 10. And I already see the front coming, so everything's happening a little sooner or a little faster than what the models had said. So just making those little adjustments as you go.
Can I ask a question before you go on there?
Yeah, sure.
It's fantastic information, and with modern day technology, you know, obviously there is a lot of software out there, and there's a lot of choices for people to pick. But you know, sometimes in our pastime, things don't always work out there. And what have you got sort of in terms of a suggestion for, you know, the software that you've got? It's all gone pear-shaped. It isn't working. But you're out there, you know, you're just rolling back in time just a little bit. How can you suggest that people don't worry about it? There are still other means that you can utilize, which are basic and simple.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a really great question. And I think there is this tendency for things to get, you know, almost overcomplicated with the weather models and stuff. That's why I always like to do some basic big picture analysis before you go on the water. You have a clear head, you know the big picture of what's happening without getting into nitty-gritty details. Then when you're out there, if things really are like, oh, this is not lining up the way I thought it was going to at all, and I think something's pretty off, then maybe don't go and try to figure out what the weather models are doing and like confuse yourself more. At that point, yeah, just go back to old school, you know, basic sailing. If you have some instruments on your boat that can help you, you can look at the wind direction. If you have a barometer, you can look at pressure. And so those two things can help you a bit. The wind direction will give you an idea of, you know, maybe which side of a low pressure you're on or which side of a high pressure you're on, because high pressure flows clockwise, low pressure flows counterclockwise. So it might give you a bit of a picture of, okay, maybe I'm on this side of the high or this side of the high. And the barometer, you know, if the pressure is rising, you're going into higher pressure. If the barometer is dropping quickly, you're headed either into a, you know, a storm of some kind, or or very closer to a low pressure. So just kind of going back to the basics, using those instruments, and then of course visual, right? Look out on the horizon, you know, sail towards blue sky, the kind of obvious things from there. And thinking about the wind direction. And I think that's why it's good to have a basic understanding of just highs and lows. And then from there, you can use your observations out there on the water and kind of navigate that way.
Yeah, that's great. That's a perfect answer. I remember sailing literally when there was times when you relied on the barometer. And
yeah,
when that barometer did start to crash, you know, you absolutely did. You went through that whole checklist that I just bullet pointed out right there. And, you know, you reef early and you do all the preparations and you rely on that barometer as absolute gospel. That is, you know, the weather is changing. And if the faster it's moving, the closer the isobars are together and stronger the wind's going to be, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And that's just having a basic picture of the highs and the lows. You're like, okay, I know we're going through this area of isobars, and from there you can adjust on the water, right? Again, those models are never going to get it exactly right.
No. And transversely, if it starts rising, you know, it's indicative that you're coming out of it.
Exactly. Yeah, things are looking up from there. Yeah, very, very good points. Yeah. So last thing about the models, when you are looking at them for your weather windows and trying to, you know, pick out maybe when's a good time, one thing to look for is just consistency among the models. So if you look at some of the major ones, like the NOAA's GFS or the ECMWF, or what people call the European model, if they're showing things that are like wildly different, that's a sign that it's probably a bad season, and it's not good that the weather models don't know what's going on, right? They're struggling to depict what's going to happen. So that's a good indicator to just say, you know what, let's not trust one or the other completely, and let's wait it out and see kind of what's going to happen. Because you want them to have some agreement there, to have confidence that, all right, this we know is going to happen, you know, give or take a few details. And the other thing, those models are updated usually 2 or sometimes 4 times a day. So if you are one of the people that's going to be downloading the grip files, maybe out on the water, you can stay updated with them. I don't recommend doing it 4 times a day. I don't even really look 4 times a day. So 2 times a day, you know, I think morning and evening is a good time to just check it out and see if anything, you know, major has changed, especially if you are expecting maybe some inclement weather and you're prepared for it, then you can say, okay, I see things have changed a little bit. But yeah, for the most part, if you're picking a good weather window, it should just be reaffirming for you that, okay, things are still, you know, looking the way we need them to. So I think that's sort of there's so much more to talk about, obviously, in these topics. And I always struggle to like get all the information in, because I love teaching this and I love talking to sailors about it. So that being said, I'm more than happy to talk to anyone that's interested, and Andrew and I'm sure would be more than happy to answer questions you guys have. One thing you can do is you can get a free weather resource guide on my website, which is sea-tactics.com, and that will give you a list of like websites and apps and just weather stuff that I use that I think is really cool for sailors. So yeah, awesome. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, that was great, Chelsea. I mean, you're absolutely right. The topic is massive. And we're always grateful for having meteorologists like yourself and to help us out. And we could talk for hours. I know I certainly could. And this is just really just like a little touch into it. But hopefully the viewers will be able to utilize people like yourself. And at the end of the day, what we're trying to do is achieve safety and people being comfortable in their passage. And it's all about enjoying the experience. And the weather has such a huge influence on that, and it can be the maker of a great passage, or it can be the breaker of a horrible one, right? And having some kind of an understanding of it, and being able to embrace whatever it throws at you through preparedness or expectant levels, it's super important. But like you, I'm here to answer any questions, and just enjoy doing the talk with you. And thanks very much again.
Yeah, thank you so much. We'll talk to you soon.
Cool, man.